Thanks, Norm.
Pretty cool. My buddy Joe over here, and I wanted him to have this. This is something I wanted to give Joe. This was Vincent Bell's original Dobro, Mosrite Dobro. And a Mobro, or whatever you want to call it, you know. So, and you know about Vincent Bell, you know, I mean, he was like a New York session guy,
yeah. And worked with Coral, made, you know, helped invent that kind of sitar harp thing, and then then that little teardrop, just, you know, down electro sitar. And yeah, Vinnie Bell was, you know, now, unfortunately, it's almost like, you know, people never realize that Clyde McCoy was a trumpet player, you know. Right. It's always a guitar, you know. It's like, do you have a Clyde McCoy? He must have been a great guitar player. No, he's actually a trumpet player, you know. But like Vinnie Bell, and you know, he was in the league of, like, you know, Tommy Tedesco and you know, all those guys that were doing everything from, you know, 7-Up jingles to TV themes and record.
And our
things.
Buddy Dell, you know, yeah. Dell was the guy who kind of put the wah-wah with guitar, you know, for the first time.
Yeah. 'Cause
it was really designed as a trumpet thing, right?
It was designed to emulate the mute of a trumpet, you know. And I could imagine back in the day with the, you know, a Shure Vocal Master PA, a trumpet, which is kind of a harsh instrument to begin with, into a microphone of some sort, into a wah-wah pedal. That, you know, if you needed to peel the paint off the walls in the store because you wanted to repaint it, that would be a good,
that would do it,
easy way to do it, you know. But no, thank you for this. We got an Americana tour coming up in about a month, and just in the back of my mind, I was like, I need to, you know, find something that's kind of interesting and a different sound. And I was just sitting over there messing with the Stratocaster, and you're like, here, I want you to have this. So thank you very much. I mean, it actually ticks the box for that.
The thing is, it sounds like a regular resonator. The pickups sound really cool, but you can tell it is a resonator guitar.
Oh, just acoustically. Something, it doesn't totally sound like a resonator through the amp, but it does something to it with the de-armings. It's really, I've seen a few of these around over the years. I never actually picked one up and messed with
them. This was probably on a lot of records at one time. And by the way, you have got to be probably the hardest working guy in show business these days, man. I mean, how many days have you toured this year?
Well, we've done about just a tick under with the crews. I think we've just done about a tick under 55 shows.
And the year's not halfway over yet.
And it, you know, a lot of people go, oh, man, you work 55 days in 6 months. Well, we don't do 55 in a row. So you're out there traveling, and you're out there, you know, a lot of rehearsing and preparing and stuff like that. And, you know, we finished a record. I made a record for Reese Winans this year.
That, by the way, what I heard of that is fantastic.
And we got some wonderful guests. Warren Haynes is on it. Keb Moe is on it. Bonnie Bramlett, Vince Gill.
Mike Finnegan.
Mike Finnegan's singing, not playing organ.
I know. It's crazy. Well, why would he play organ with Reese there?
You know, and you know, it's one of those things where, you know, Mike Ferris and Mike Finnegan sing this this song called That Drive and Beat. And, you know, when I first agreed to produce a record, I've never produced a record before, and I just kind of went into my phone and was like, hey, do you want to play on a record for me? And they're like, well, what is it? And Reese Winans, and like everybody just signed up immediately. So there's a lot of love for Reese, and that'll be out next January, and we're just finishing it now. So that's really exciting. And, you know, but please don't call me to produce a record. My hairline can't take it.
I can't produce my record.
No. I originally turned Reese down because I didn't want the responsibility. But once I kind of saw the opportunity to, like, really go, hey, Reese, he's been in this business for 50 years. He's played with everyone from Boss Scaggs to Stevie Ray Vaughan. He's a member of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, multiple Grammy winner, and a true national treasure, you know, especially on the keyboards and just as a human being. And I said, you know what? If I was going to do one in my life, that'd be the one I'd do. And I'm so honored that everybody showed up. Doyle Bramhall came and just killed it. I mean, it was just one of those things where there was so much love for that man. Kenny Wayne Shepherd came in. We had the original Double Trouble Band and Kenny Wayne Shepherd doing Riviera Paradise and all this. I don't want to give away the titles, but, you know, it's one of those kind of records that when you hear it, it's just a celebration of music and this man's life in music, but it's not like it's a keyboard record, but it's just a good music record. So I'm very excited about it.
Kenny Wayne's going to be on the cruise next year, right?
He is. And, you know, he and I have known each other 20 years or more. And we've never shared the stage together, which I always go,
because you guys are running parallel.
And, you know, we know each other, we're good friends. And I'm like, you know, isn't it odd? Isn't it odd? So we're gonna try to remedy that. And, you know, he's had such a great career and such a great player, and, you know, he's a guitar geek like us. He's really into cars, and we have a lot in common. We're the same age, and we've kind of, you know, done things in tandem and in parallel, and, you know, and so that's gonna be great. And we have Ruthie Foster coming next year, and cool. It's sold out already.
Sarah Rogo, who's one of our faves around here, she's great.
And, you know, it's sold out in 5 days, and it's just a testament to the fans and this great community that we've been building over the last 5 years, that people enjoy themselves, they love music. And the thing I've taken from these cruises is it's not about sailing to some exotic island. It's about getting, you know, 2,600 like-minded people who like this kind of music, and just presenting bands that you both know, and most importantly, bands that you don't know that you should go see.
And the quality of the musicianship on the cruise, though, I mean, you know, you pick out the acts, there's some really terrific stuff. I mean, you walk from one venue on the ship to the next, and it's like a blow mind. You kind of, you know, after 4 days, it's about as much music as anybody can stand.
Exactly, I mean, and that's why we do a 4-day cruise, because it's an intense 4 days, not only for the participants, but for the fans. And it does get a bit overwhelming, you know. But yeah, we've had some great, I mean, Josh and Kirk come every year, which is great. And they're my friends, and, you know, we've had some new people coming.
James Hunter, who I love, I mean, a lot of people don't know about, who I think is great. Plus, you know, at the end of the night, there are the jams up in the, in the showrooms and stuff like that, which if they haven't gotten enough by playing, all these guys afterwards sit in together, and it's really a happening. I mean, it's really terrific stuff.
And, you know, it's the Marcus King, and the cross-pollination between the bands. And what I've really enjoyed in the last couple of years is, you know, I have a large touring band. You know, we're 8-piece, sometimes 9-piece, sometimes 11-piece. You know, we just a tick under an orchestra sometimes. And what I've been loving is the subgroups that have formed. You know, Pauly Serra is a wonderful musician.
He's fantastic. When he did his solo thing on there too, that was killer, killer, killer. Pauly is just so great. And I didn't realize what a great keyboard player he is.
And a singer, you know.
He's a great singer.
A world-class singer, keyboardist, writer, blues singer. And, you know, and Mahalia Barnes. And it's great to see, like, you know, at any given point, any or all of my group could be playing with somebody else's group. And they have fun, and it's about music, and it's about a community, and it's about it's really just about celebrating, you know, a type of music that everybody's loved and dedicated their lives to, and getting up there and having some fun, and hopefully not too many martinis. That's the trick.
But
when
it
you
is
get up and
keeping
jam.
The blues alive. It really is. I mean, it's doing so much for a lot of these artists that need to get discovered, need to be seen, and you know, the fact that you're picking out the best of the best and putting them all together on one thing and making a community out of it with all these guys, so they all know each other and double bill and whatever.
And truth be told, it's a music cruise. You know, I know there's another blues cruise, and that's, you know, Roger's done a great job for almost 30 years, and he's a wonderful guy and has a great boat. You know, we kind of sail in a divergent channel. Not to, you know, we're a music cruise. I mean, to call my music straight blues is like calling, you know, it's like using this guitar, you know, as, you know, some, you know, putting it in a pilot seat of a commercial aircraft. I mean, it's not quite the right fit. I mean, so, you know, my thing has always been music. It doesn't have, like, we had Black Country Communion on a blues cruise. I mean, that's as far away from the blues as it gets.
Well, but Bruce Hornsby too.
And Bruce Hornsby
wasn't necessarily.
But it's a music cruise, and because I understand the concept, like, I have musical ADD. I actually have ADD to begin with. And the thing
I've seen Nerdville. I mean, that's a testimony to your ADD.
Blinking lights, yeah. And the idea is more so than not is I understand that my fans who like blues and blues rock music also like Led Zeppelin, also like Americana, also like, you know, straight up heavy metal, you know. I mean, so we kind of try to service that angle where it's not just a straight Chicago blues band. We have Chicago blues, but it's also a little bit different. So, I'm not trying to sell anybody. I sound like a used car salesman.
It's sold out.
It's sold out.
So there's nothing to sell.
You know, like,
but and if you want a ticket for the following year, you better get it quick.
I got an '87 Buick Skylark outside. So it's $1,800 as long as there's no follow-up questions. You know, I mean, like, it's not used.
All right. Well, the great Joe Bonamassa, thank you as always.
Thank you, Norm.
You come by. Your family and, you know, I love your folks. I love your band. I mean, all the people that you're involved with are good people, and it's no pretense, just great plan. And
you know what? I mean, I swear to God, I was looking for something just like to tick this box, and we're doing a DVD at the Ryman this summer, and If I have anything to say with it, this thing will end up at the Ryman in a couple months.
You just got to spray out the volume pot and everything will be cool.
By the way, guitars I use every day when they travel, and especially old guitars when they go outside, especially Fenders and 335s, it doesn't matter. If you go outside and it's high humidity or they travel overseas, the first day, the first 3 days, it's...
You got to work it in.
And you know what? We used to get real, like, freaked out about it. Now I just let it go because it's just part of the charm. It's like driving an old car. You know, the new cars are faster, they're more comfortable, they have satellite navigation, they will drive themselves now. Driving an old car, you have to honor it, you drive slower, and it's more fun. And that's the thing about old guitars. It's like, this is fun for me.
There you go.
It makes it interesting.
So, take us out with a little bit more.
All right.
Baby.
There you go.
Woo!
Thanks.